Waking the Dead by John Eldredge. This audio version is published by Oasis Audio through an agreement with Thomas Nelson Publishers. Waking the Dead is read by Kelly Ryan Dolan with a special introduction by the author.
Part 1. Seeing Our Way Clearly. The way through the world is more difficult to find than the way beyond it. Wallace Stevens. Narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Jesus of Nazareth. There are few things more crucial to us than our own lives, and there are few things we are less clear about. This journey we are taking is hardly down the yellow brick road. Then again, that is not a bad analogy at all. We may set out in the light with hope and joy, but eventually our path always seems to lead us into the woods, shrouded with a low-lying mist. Where is this abundant life that Christ supposedly promised? Where is God when we need Him most? What is to become of us? The cumulative effect of days upon years that we do not really understand is a subtle erosion. We come to doubt our place. We come to question God's intentions toward us. And we lose track of the most important things in life. We're not fully convinced that God's offer to us is life. We have forgotten that the heart is central, and we had no idea that we were born into a world at war.
Chapter 1. Arm Yourselves. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they might have life and have it to the full. Jesus of Nazareth, John 10:10. We in the world, my children, will always be at war. Retreat is impossible. Arm yourselves. Leif Enger. We were running low on fuel, and still the fog refused to lift. Icy Strait spread out below us, beautiful and threatening. I've always loved the ocean, the wilder the better. But clearly, this was no place to run out of gas. If by chance we survived ditching the small plane, we'd last about 7 minutes in those waters. The nearest chance at rescue lived more than 40 minutes away. Great, this is just how it happens, I thought. We'll make Reader's Digest. Family on vacation, lost in fatal crash. Rain and mist smeared the windshield as we strained our eyes ahead, searching for a break in the clouds. There's no radar in these planes. Bush pilots fly VFR. Visual flight restrictions. If you can't see where you're going, well, then, mister, you can't go there. And you can't keep trying forever, either. The clock that's running is the fuel gauge. 3 more minutes, and we'll have to turn back. We'll give it one more pass. Fairweather Mountain is a total misnomer. With a name like that, don't you picture some lovely place in Hawaii or maybe Costa Rica? Balmy breezes, gentle green slopes, the weather always, well, fair. These mountains explode 15,000 feet or more above sea level, right off the coast of southeastern Alaska. Sheer cliffs and foreboding glaciers. Some of the world's worst weather hangs out here. The pilot was yelling above the drone of the engine. They get their name because you can only see them in fair weather. How cute. What idiot came up with that cleverness? Raw fear had swallowed my sense of humor whole. They ought to have named it the Peaks of Frozen Death or Don't Even Think About It Mountains. Fair weather? Around here, that means maybe 20 days a year, if you're lucky. We got lucky. And I have never seen anything more breathtaking in all my life. We banked along vertical granite walls that rose and fell thousands of feet on either side, like a sparrow gliding among the Himalayas. Are those waterfalls? I asked, pointing to several cascades of white falling through thin air over the black cliffs. Avalanches. Must be warm up here today. Massive crevices in the glaciers below held pools of clear water, a color I never knew existed, something between azure and cerulean blue. Those cracks are so big we could fly right down them. I pretended not to hear. I felt we'd slipped through death's grasp, and I didn't want to give him another swipe. the beauty that now engulfed us was enough. 20 clear days a year. That sounds about like my life. I think I see what's really going on about that often. The rest of the time, it feels like fog, like the bathroom mirror after a hot shower. You know what I mean. What exactly are you perfectly clear on these days? How about your life? Why have things gone the way they have? Where was God in all of that? And you know what you ought to do next, with a deep, settled confidence that it will work out? Neither do I. Oh, I'd love to wake each morning knowing exactly who I am and where God is taking me. Zeroed in on all my relationships, undaunted in my calling. It's awesome when I do see. But for most of us, life seems more like driving along with a dirty windshield and then turning into the sun. I can sort of make out the shapes ahead, and I think the light is green. Wouldn't a little bit of clarity go a long way right now? Let's start with why life is so dang hard. You try to lose a little weight, but it never seems to happen. You think of making a shift in your career, maybe even serving God, but you never actually get to do it. Perhaps a few of you do make the jump, but it rarely pans out the way you thought. You try to recover something in your marriage, and your spouse looks at you with a glance that says, "Nice try," or "Isn't it a little late for that?" And the thing actually blows up into an argument in front of the kids. Yes, we have our faith, but even there, maybe especially there, it all seems to fall rather short of the promise. There's talk of freedom and abundant life, of peace like a river and joy unspeakable, but we see precious little of it, to be honest. Why is it that, as Tillich said, it's only here and there in the world and now and then in ourselves we see any evidence of a new creation? Here and there, now and then. In other words, not much. When you stand them side by side, the description of the Christian life, practically shouted in the New Testament compared with the actual life of most Christians, it's embarrassing. Paul sounds like a madman, and we look a little foolish, like children who've been held back a grade. Why is it that nearly every good thing, from taking the annual family vacation, to planning a wedding, to cultivating a relationship, takes so much work? It's almost as if there is something set against us. Some dear friends of mine just returned from a 3-week vacation in France. It had been their dream for nearly 25 years. What could be more romantic than strolling along the Champs-Élysées in the evening, as lovers do? It seemed an ideal way to celebrate their 25th wedding anniversary. They'd both served God faithfully for decades, but over the years, a European rendezvous seemed about as reachable as the moon. Then, late last fall, things suddenly came together. Friends of theirs were headed to Europe and offered 2 tickets to come along. Time off was available. They were going to France. And right after they made it to Paris, it all fell apart. Craig came down with walking pneumonia. Lori wanted to leave the third day. All sorts of issues in their marriage surfaced. But since they were with friends, the issues mostly played themselves out in their own thoughts, which tended toward divorce. It wasn't romantic. It was hard. Afterward, as we talked on the phone about the whole thing, Lori said, "Life never seems to turn out the way you think it will, about 90% of the time." No kidding. Haven't we all got a story that goes with that little bumper sticker? Just the day before, I received another call. That was the morning our son Blaine was to have his final cardiologist appointment, and I was anxious to hear the news. Now, I know that every parent thinks his child is head and shoulders above the rest, but I'm telling you, Blaine is a special one. He turned 11 this year, and he's one of the healthiest, happiest kids I've ever known. His heart is so good, so spiritually aware, so keen to the hearts of others. He's surprisingly compassionate for a boy his age, and he's also the most courageous one of us all. When it comes to rock climbing or cliff jumping or skiing, Blaine is always the first to go for it. He's a great athlete and a talented artist and a riot when it comes to his humor. He plays the violin, he memorizes cowboy poetry, he blows stuff up, he wants to be a Jedi Knight. I love this boy. And it's a long story of prayer and hope and worry over Blaine. When he was young, his pediatrician picked up an anomaly in his heart during a routine checkup. The cardiologist confirmed through a battery of tests that, indeed, Blaine had several holes in his heart. "He'll need surgery," he said. We opted to wait until Blaine was older, to give God a chance to intervene. The thought of putting my son under open-heart surgery gave me the shudders. Over the course of those years, we spent many nights in prayer that God would heal Blaine's heart. During one of those times, Stacy, not usually given to visions, had a picture of a light penetrating his heart. At that moment, she felt certain God had healed him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.